We're at the Gampton Creek Boatyard, Devon. This is the restoration project of the sailing ketch Windweaver. Windweaver is owned by Martyn Cox along with Philip Henton. So let's ask one of the owners and captain, Martyn Cox, for an introduction into Windweaver and outline the scope of the restoration work.
Right. This is a restoration project on a boat called Windweaver. This is a one-off design wooden boat. The designer was a chap by the name of O'Brien Kennedy. And the actual builder was a chap who lived in Somerset. His name was Harry Kimber. It was in 1962. She wasn't commissioned fully until 1980. She's had a lot of hard work, and so we're going to completely revamp her. the idea is that we're going to get her ready for a race, which is going to take place in June 2015. It's to use oars in that. What we've had to do is we've had to take the mast off to lay a tent to around this because we're working during the winter. We've had to remove the keel, and to remove the keel, we've had to remove the engine. We're going to replace several planks below the waterline, and we're going to put a new deck on that. So we're going to be taking this old deck off completely. We'll be renewing the rotten timbers underneath where the fresh water's actually crept in. It's rotten in places. So those will be replaced. Then we'll put a marine ply subdeck down. That will be then fiberglass, and then we're going to lay a new Aroco deck on top of that, and then we'll re-cork it. So we're on a pretty tight time schedule because the relaunch date is actually only 3 months away. We've got it going in the 6th of March. And we'll have to do a 300-mile qualifying race first of all before the A's out, and that's probably done by May. So this is going to be done with the aid of shipwrights, Rob Biss and Ian Burgess. They were very experienced, and I'm welcoming their involvement pretty soon, I hope. Right. So the further thing that we need to do to this boat is to re-cork it all completely from right beneath the waterline, right to the top of the deck. And each one of these areas where the plank meets, there's a gap. So this has to be raked out, all the old putty and any old oakum, which is the stuff which is placed in between there. So it will be repacked with oakum, and then the putty will be forced into the timbers all the way up below and above the waterline. So it will give it a really good watertight seal. That's the hope. The oakum and the putty will probably start coming out a bit, over the year as she swells up. The timber swells in the water, squeeze it out a little bit more. So it will need repainting a couple of times at least. So we'll put her in with a couple of coats of paint on, but probably by the end of the summer we'll have to get her out, sand her back again, and do the painting yet again.
All you young fellas that follow the sea,
to me way, hey, blow the man down.
Now please pay attention and listen to me.
Give me some time to blow the man down.
I'm a deep water sailor, just come from Hong Kong.
To me way, hey, blow the man down.
If you give me some whiskey, I'll sing you a song.
Woo! Give me some time to blow the man down.
On a trim black ball liner, I first served me time.
To me way, hey, blow the man down.
On a trim black ball liner, I wasted me prime.
Give me some time to blow the man down.
When a her big black ball liners are leaving her dock.
Jimmy, way, hey, blow the man down.
The boys and the girls on the pierhead do flock.
Give me some time to blow the man down.
Now when the big liner, she's clear of the land.
Jimmy, way, hey, blow the man down.
Well, our bo'sun, he roars out the word of command.
Ooh. Give me some time to blow the man down.
Come quickly, lay after the break of the poop.
Jimmy, way, hey, blow the man down.
Or I'll help you along with the toe of me boot.
Give me some time to blow the man down.
Pay attention to orders now, you one and all.
Jimmy, way, hey, blow the man down.
For see high above you, there flies the black ball.
Give me some time to blow the man down.
Melt as larboard and starboard, on deck you will sprawl.
Jimmy, way, hey, blow the man down.
For kicking Jim Woodyard commands the black ball.
Woo! Give me some time to blow the man down.
First week in December, we're just going to catch up with Phil Henton on how the restoration project of Windweaver is progressing.
Right, as you can see, we've now removed the deck on the advice of our shipwright, only to expose a few more problems. Deck beams rot the shelving, so at the moment I'm in the process of taking some more bits off, as you can see, to expose more bits that aren't very good. She's going to cheer the boss up again. Obviously with the extra faults we've been finding, we're a little bit behind time, that's why I've come down to help Martyn, supply some labour, and learn a few new skills hopefully.
Right.
While the deck's off, we've got full access to our steering quadrant, which is going to be fully serviced. We'll check the steel cables which operate the rudder before it goes back on to make sure it's all nice and
free.
Free.
Right, well, Rob's identified the problem with the chain plates. We've got 10 on the boat to be replaced. They're grossly inadequate, the ones which were there in the first place. They're rotting away, so we're going to have new ones made. They're going to run the whole next to the boat. To the pier, so yeah, we'll be holding the boat together as well. So here is one of the chain plates to give you some idea of what we look like. This metal, so we've got a galvanizing that attached to the beam shell, which is not a good idea, so we've been told now to run them all the way down the side of the boat, with the extra string.
Right, the reason the deck's coming off is because the ply sub deck is leaking around undercovering board. It's leaked onto the beam shells and taken out the ends of the beams and the half beams and the main beams.
It's straight
down to six.
It's identified a problem with the chain plates, virtually inadequate. And it needs to be made in a different manner. Quite rotted out as well.
I reckon probably the owner laid, ripped off all of this and laid the plugs.
Australia round Cape Horn,
and we're bound for South Australia.
So haul away, you rolling cane.
Heave away, haul away.
Oh, haul away, and you hear me sing.
And we're bound for South Australia.
Well, I walked outside one morning,
Timmy.
Heave away, haul away.
Well, chance to meet with Nancy Blair.
And we're bound for South Australia.
So haul away, you rolling cane.
Heave away, haul away.
Oh, haul away, and you hear me sing.
And we're bound for South Australia.
Well, I shook her up and I shook her down.
Heave away, haul away.
Oh, I danced her round and round the town.
And we're bound for South Australia.
So haul away, you rolling cane.
Heave away, haul away.
Oh, haul away, and you hear me sing.
And we're bound for South Australia.
I wish I was on a lonesome strand.
Heave away, haul away.
With rum and whiskey all in hand.
And we're bound for South Australia.
So haul away, you rolling cane.
Heave away, haul away.
Oh, haul away, and you hear me sing.
And we're bound for South Australia.
Now two old women lying on the sand.
Heave away, haul away.
Each one wishing that the other was a man.
And we're bound for South Australia.
So haul away, you rolling king.
Heave away, haul away.
Oh, haul away, and you hear me sing.
And we're bound for South Australia.
And as we wall up around Cape Horn,
heave away, haul away.
You wish to Christ you'd never been born.
And we're bound for South Australia.
So haul away, you rolling king.
Heave away, haul away.
Oh, haul away, and you hear me sing.
And we're bound for South Australia.
Oh, South Australia's a bloody fine place. And you hear me sing,
and we're bound for South Australia.
Now, the second week of January 2015, we're going to have a quick chat with Phil Henton to find out what's been going on with the Windweaver project over the Christmas period.
At the moment, Ian, who's downstairs at the moment, you may hear him banging occasionally, he's putting a cotton in to the seams above the waterline, and below the waterline we use a oakum, which is a much more oily, harder substance, much more waterproof. And then once he's done that, which takes him rather a long time, and then we're using a linseed oil based putty, which they mix red lead powder with and some more natural linseed oil. And it's a steady old job. Thumb it in, trail it back, wait for that to go off maybe 3 weeks before we can sand it. And then we can undercoat her and think about maybe starting to paint. Okay, another job that we're doing to make the boat structurally safer is this window here. It was one complete window. 8mm laminate glass, plastic glass, and we're going to laminate it. But what we're going to do is, we're making a template, we're going to make the window into two now, which will make it a lot stronger. So that's another little job that's on the go. This is what it will look like when it's done. Hopefully you can see
makes them a lot stronger. It'll be let in, mitered, glued. We're going to shuffle the glass in here and here, and the original quadrant will go back round and just get the window back in, making it a whole lot stronger in big waves, heavy storm weather. Situ allowance time. As you can see, Rob has made a new transom for the stern, which is biscuited together, laminated, a Roco, to replace the oak one that was on there that had been damaged two or three times previously, and people had badly repaired it. And once the deck was off, we were able to see the amount of damage and rot that was actually in it. He's busy up his workshop at the moment, making two pieces to go on the end. Once that's all back together, he's going to start steaming the beam shafts. Okay, as we can see, Rob's done a really nice job of making this. Got a nice shape back on the stern of the boat. Very difficult for him to do. Normally that would be on the boat before the planks, and then they would let them all up underneath to it. He's had to do it in reverse order, which makes it twice as difficult. Very complicated, but as you can see, he's done a really nice job.
It's February 2015, we're on the Windweaver projects, and we're catching up with Phil Henton to just see how the project's progressing.
So, we've made a little bit of progress, and these are the beam shafts that are now steamed and cut and shaped, ready to drop in to replace the old ones which we've got the rot in. Doing that this week. Unfortunately, that's one step forward. We have a step backwards here though on the doghouse. We needed to access one or two things, and in doing so we found a little bit more rot. So as you can see, we've exposed this area here, which was green ply, had faced on the outside, nice cheap boarding. Unfortunately, when they constructed it, they didn't really seal the marine ply, and the teak boarding was not tongued and grooved, it's just V'd, so any moisture getting in there has been trapped, and we've had to take it all out because it's all rather rotten. Okay, so as we can see, it's fully exposed now. Also, excuse me while I get a bit closer here, in taking the seat out, we've exposed a bit of a problem with the teak. We're going to have to let a new piece into here, which carries the window hatches. We spoke about last time, we were going to make them smaller. Going to have to replace these posts as well, because as you can see down here, we're starting to get some rot. And the same on this one here. And then we'll be putting marine ply back on here, sealing it properly this time, before we put the teak back over the face of it. Fortunately, we've managed to salvage most of the teak, and when it's sanded down, we should be able to reuse it. We've practically finished the stern transom now. We've given him a lot of headaches, but apart from finding a little bit of shaping in a few places, nearly complete. Still got one or two planks to replace underneath, but until we get the new beam shaft in, we're reluctant to take one or two pieces out. It's obviously keeping the shape of the boat together. But yeah, pretty much there on the stern now. So here we have the aft beams. We've used 3-inch by 1-inch strips of Roco. I laminated 5 of those together to give us a nice strong deck, and it's all on there, support. A little bit of sanding to do on them, but pretty much there on those again. Just going to need to be cut to length once our beam shelves are in.
Better?
Taking the old beach shelves out, put the new ones back in. Both sides.
Waiting for the day that we get our pay. Off Orford Ness she sprang a leak. Hear her poor old timbers creak. And we're waiting for the day, waiting for the day, waiting for the day that we get our pay. We pumped our way round last of Ness when the wind back ran to the west, southwest. And we're waiting for the day, waiting for the day, waiting for the day that we get our pay. Through the Cockle to Cromer Cliff, steering like a wagon with a wheel adrift. And we're waiting for the day, waiting for the day, waiting for the day that we get our pay. Into the Humber and up the town, pump you blighters, pump or drown. And we're waiting for the day, waiting for the day, waiting for the day that we get our pay. Her coal was shot by a Kidby crew, her bottom was rotten and it went right through. So we're waiting for the day, waiting for the day, waiting for the day that we get our pay.
So Martyn, do you think the boat has now sort of reached a point where it's getting back together again rather than taking it apart?
Well, we've reached the turning point now. So most of the hull has been re-corked. We've got the few loose ends at the front here to tie up. And once we get the plank back in, we're pretty much done with the hull. That's just the top side. So,
you're pleased how the work's going ahead so far?
Yes, yeah, now it's starting to come back together. We can see some light at the end of the tunnel. The benefit from all of this work is the boat is much stiffer and much stronger. These beams we've made have been laminated to give us the extra strength. And our craft beams are much, much thicker than the originals we took out. So we're going to have a pretty stiff boat to sail in the future. So we'll have no give at all.
So the other job that now is nearly complete is the deck beams are nearly all in. The full ones, these have been laminated, as we spoke last time. Full ones are in, and quite a few of the half beams are now in as well. As we said, deck beams are in. Martin's given them a couple of coats of varnish. Obviously easy to do that before we put the deck on, and when we have to paint the deck underneath, hopefully we'll be able to wipe all the paint off, because we're not very good at painting.
Right, well, as Phil said earlier, we've been taking out a number of the old fastenings. These are all bond fittings, and they've not been holding very well. And you can see from this, what's actually been happening is the water's got in behind it, corroded it, and it's caused what I call a coning effect, destroying it in the middle there. So on the safe side, we've taken them all out at the ends of each of the beams. And so at the back and the front, and all along the garboards, we've actually removed all the screws. We've placed them with stainless steel, and then we've had to re-plug them. Hopefully we shouldn't have any further problems for another 50 years. I'll be gone by then. And all the lighter patches are the wooden plugs that we've replaced. And one plank which we need to replace on the boat. Obviously this one here. You can see the thickness of the planks extremely good for this type of boat, much thicker than need be. Obviously fitting the one in this particular position is going to be the hardest to fit because of the curvature and the way that the diminishes in size, so you have to get a really tight fit in there. So that's the next job. We've checked all the through-hole fittings and we've found two in need of replacing. One being here and the other one on the same side, just a bit more for the boat. And
we've got the official screens in this, which we'll be doing today.
So this is the keel from the boat. Probably weighs at least 3 tons. It's mainly lead. I think probably it's concrete encapsulated with the lead. Uncertain because we haven't tested it. But yes, it's a fairly unusual shape. Eight bronze bolts, and the bolts are the bolts are coming out quite nicely, and they're in good nick. But the all the nuts need to be replaced, so having some new ones machined up. And this would be one of the last things to go back on when we've got the rest of the boat ready. So I'm looking forward to that day. Right.
We're getting closer.
Yeah.
Every day.
So there's a chance it'll actually sail again.
Yeah. Oh yes, one way or another. We sink or swim.
And we'll roll the old chariot along.
We'll roll the old chariot along. We'll roll the old chariot along. And we'll all hang on behind.
And a drop of Nelson's blood wouldn't do us any harm.
A drop of Nelson's blood wouldn't do us any harm. A drop of Nelson's blood wouldn't do us any harm. And we'll all hang on behind. And we'll roll the old chariot along. We'll roll the old chariot along. We'll roll the old chariot along. And we'll all hang on behind.
And another drop of rum wouldn't do us any harm.
Another drop of rum wouldn't do us any harm. Another drop of rum wouldn't do us any harm. And we'll all hang on behind. And we'll roll.
Any harm.
Another pint of ale wouldn't do us any harm. Another pint of ale wouldn't do us any harm. And we'll all hang on behind. And we'll roll the old chariot along. We'll roll the old chariot along. We'll roll the old chariot along. And we'll all hang on behind.
And another watch below wouldn't do us any harm.
Another watch below wouldn't do us any harm. Another watch below wouldn't do us any harm. And we'll all hang on behind.
This is Rob Biss, the master shipwright, who's been working on the Windweaver project since it began. Rob, can you just run through some of the items that you found in this restoration project that have given you most of the problems?
Condition of the boat when we first started. The boat itself was in very good condition. Hull-wise, there was no real issue with it at all. The main issue with it was the decks were badly laid. It's taking out beam shells, taking out deck beams. And then taking out the counter stern sections, which is probably one of the hardest jobs in doing the whole boat, really. It's getting the whole stern section rebuilt. When we took the deck off, we found that the chain plates, which were bolted through the beam shelves, were only attached to the beam shelves. They weren't actually attached to the hull. So they all had to come out and be extended all the way down the hull to spread the load throughout the hull. Now we've got the counter stern section in, we've now got the beam shells in, with all the beams fitted. I've just fared in the whole aft section, and then we've put in the new king planks and the new pads to take the aft cleats. We've had to adjust the windows because they were found to be too big for the racing they're going to be doing in the future. So we put in this centre section here to make it into two smaller windows. We've also replaced all the joints because the joints were found to be bad. They're badly fitted from the original. So they've all been rebuilt on both sides. And on the other side, we've put in a whole section here. When the bulk of it was rotten, it took out the cabin side. Yeah, the bow section. Now fed most of the beams in. Phil has put in the forward hatchway with the half beams for here. I've just put a centre line down to run in the new king planks. So the forward end is pretty much done. By the end of the week it will be nearly ready to put the fly on.
Okay, so today we're beefing up the bowsprit plates. This is the original one that came off. This is our nice big new one, which drops down in here, and then the king plank will come through, sit over the top. Once the deck's on, bowsprit back on there, much more strength, stop her flexing at all. Especially fabricated for Windweaver. Because obviously nothing on two boats is alike, so everything normally on Windweaver, unfortunately, we have to have specially fabricated. Once I finish putting this bowsprit mount in, we can drop the king planking completely. The mooring rope fasteners are going to go down onto these extra large reinforcing plates. Because obviously she's got a big heavy boat and it's no good just bolting through the deck. So these have been let into the beams and glued and screwed down, so it can give us a nice good mounting point for the port and starboard bow lines. Also extra large plates here. Either side the king plank, which have been let in, they're just ready for screwing and gluing down now, and they're going to be for the anchor winch mounts, which obviously takes a lot of strain again, so same as much more reinforcing underneath the deck, so it doesn't put the load on the deck. Obviously as we move further back down the boat, this is where the mast is going to go. Obviously same again, reinforcing either side the king plank, so when the mast goes on, in the boot, on the deck, nice and strong, you're not going to get any movement. Because with our wooden boat, the mast goes right down through and bolts to the keel. Whereas a lot of fiberglass boats, they're called a step mast, which is basically just bolted down onto the sole. But ours goes through the ring and not going to move anywhere. Very hard to get a knockdown as well, break the mast.
Yeah, we're now fitting all the pads onto the deck. to take all the cleats. We've got the tracks. We've got two tracks on this boat. This is one of the last ones to go in, which is what which takes one of the main tracks. We'll see if it'll fit. Hopefully it will.
Saturday morning down here on Windweaver. Unfortunately, unfortunately for Rob, he had a 40th birthday yesterday, so he's not here this morning, obviously suffering a little bit. But anyway, we're not here to talk about him. It's the chain plates today. As you can see, they've been sent away and we've had the top foot polished up really nicely. Been bent to shape of a hole. So they now obviously drop down in there. Fit nice and snug. All we've got to do now is they've got to be bolted. We've pre-drilled them, every other beam. They need to be cranked a little bit to pick up when the mast is on the stays. Okay, so chain plates need bending to the shape of the hole. Each one's going to be slightly different, so we've made up a special little jig here and a scaffold. And in we go, just gradually keep tweaking until we get the right shape or near enough, and then obviously it's out and back in just to see where we need or if we need a little bit more tweaking anywhere else. But that one seems to be sitting in there pretty nice. It's maybe a couple of millimeters away from the hole in places, but when it's bolted together we'll be able to take that up.
Good.
Okay, so chain plates in. We have a bit of a divide between the chain plate and the inner beam shell. So what we're going to do, make some timber packers, which will be grooved in the back, go around, fit down nice and snugly inside, like so. And then under the beam shells, we've got these brackets which are going to get welded on. So when the beam shell's in, so packer in there, then this is going to get welded underneath the beam shell, with the extra strength coming off of it as well. So not only will the load be on the hole, it'll be on the beam shell, but not as it was before, because obviously we're bolting it through the hole as well. Okay, so new bowsprit plates in, all bolted down, so we've now got a king plank in, finished. All the extra supports all glued, screwed. Now just
bit of painting, brighten it up inside, because it's obviously quite dark up this end of the boat. It's going to need another coat. She's had one primer, undercoat, and it's having another coat before the top coat goes on. Okay, so chain plates are now in. There were originally another one here, one parallel to us, but when we have our big foresail up, try and sheet in very tight, you just get distorted around the shroud from mast. So between Rob, our shipwright, and the rigger, they've designed a way of removing these two, one either side. We're having one in the centre now, which will be hanked on, which means it can actually be removed from the point of fixing, moved out of the way in light winds when you really want to use the sail at its best. So heavy weather, we can attach it back on, and that will give the mast the support that it needs in the bad weather.
A song.
Woo! Give me some time to blow the man down.
On a trim black ball liner, I first served me time.
Tim me away, hey, blow the man down.
On a trim black ball liner, I wasted me prime.
Give me some time to blow the man down.
When a big black ball liner's a leaving her dock.
Tim me away, hey, blow the man down.
The boys and the girls on the pierhead do flock.
Give me some time to blow the man down.
Now when the big liner, she's clear of the land.
To me, way, hey, blow the man down.
Well, our bo'sun, he roars out the word of command.
Ooh. Give me some time to blow the man down.
Come quickly, lay after the break of the poop.
To me, way, hey, blow the man down.
Or I'll help you along with the toe of me boot.
Give me some time to blow the man down.
Pay attention to orders now, you one and all.
To me, way, hey, blow the man down.
For see high above you, there flies the black ball.
Give me some time to blow the man down.
Melt as larboard and starboard, on deck you will sprawl.
To me, way, hey, blow the man down.
For kicking Jim Woodyard commands the black ball.
Woo! Give me some time to blow the man down.
So I've been away for a few weeks, and I've just returned to see the progress they've made on the boat. Unfortunately, the progress hasn't gone as quickly as we would expect. We've had to withdraw from the ASAB race. Definitely won't be ready in time for that this year. Great disappointment, but never mind, things are going to be done properly. We've reached a stage now where we've got the second layer of marine ply going down on the deck, which we're epoxied together. And then when that's finished, we'll get another epoxy layer on top of that. I'll use a heat gun to make it go into the wood. Totally waterproof the entire deck. Then we've got the Iroko deck to go down on top of that, which is purely going to be for aesthetic purposes. We're only going to make the boat look good. It's not necessary to keep it watertight. Now, until that's done, we can't get the canopy off. Can't take the scaffolding down. So we're pretty keen to get our finish. As soon as we can get the scaffolding down, we can then progress with getting the keel back on, which is going to be quite a difficult job. But once that's back on, we'll be able to get the engine replaced and also the mast reinstalled. So yeah, there's a lot to do. We're still under the schedule because I have entered the boat for the classic channel regatta this year, which is on the 11th of July. I dearly want to make that date.
So, fingers crossed. Right, well, the one plus point in all this is going to be the boat will be a different boat to sail. She'll be much stiffer, much quicker to respond, and hopefully a lot faster than she was before. Because before there's just too much flexibility in the boat. They've got a really rigid now, and it should make a huge difference to the way she attacked much quicker, and she'll pick up quickly. We have invested in some new sails as well, so hopefully that's going to give us another advantage. There's a little bit more weight to the boat. I think what we'll have to do is get the boat weighed so we can have our handicap redone. I'm very confident that the boat will be a completely different boat to sail.
Okay, so the back of the bulkhead is all back together now. 18mm marine ply. We've put 18mm of a Roco cladding on the outside of it now. It's all glued on. Full plug. Sanded back, ready to go now, so that can all be sanded. Obviously the hole for the porthole. Recess back in, so it can go back in when it's done. All the seating areas are back together. Doors, everything all been hung, so make sure they fit again exactly where they were. And so it's now ready for sanding, and then it can start to get some varnish on it. Keep the sun on. Put the cladding on. We pre-fiberglass 6 inches all the way around in the inner cockpit. So it's more like a bathtub now. Hopefully we won't get any leaks anywhere apart from where it's supposed to, which is down these holes to let the water out to the outside. We've reconfigured the one locker here a little bit, which before it's a large locker because it used to be a quarter berth, same identical as that side, but they obviously had problems with it. To make the galley a bit more room for them, they blocked it off and they made a rope locker out of it. But as you can see, a rather large area, very difficult to get into, and the gas bottles used to be here, which we've now moved. So when we've put all this back together, all we've done now is we've made this so we can lift this out, put it in there, rather large, get in there to access things, got a lot more storage areas. So it's the third week of July now, we're a little bit behind schedule, but the deck is finally laid. It's been very time consuming because you've got your outer margin board, and obviously when each plank comes in, they've got a funny name around here, they call them toggles. It's where they join them, butt them up, so each one has to be done separately, take it off, put it back on, very time consuming. But finally it's down, it's been glued and it's screwed down, stainless steel screws. And we're nearly finishing putting all the plugs in, which is about 2,500 we reckon. Hatch is all back on, finished now, so yeah, looking pretty good.
Can you just explain why they're called toggles and what's the point of this toggle cutting?
So yeah, talking about the toggles, which is a local Devon name apparently, the reason why they're done like that is they like to leave them about an inch and a half wide cut in, so you have some timber left to actually put a screw towards the end, because obviously if you've got a pointy end here, you're trying to put a screw in, it's going to split. So deck's laid, plugs are going in, just doing the last few now. So a little bit of glue, squidge it out into the hole, take your plug, little twist, get it to line up with the grain, because that's how we want them. Wherever the grain is, the plug should aim towards it. So when you sand them, it makes it easier, and obviously it looks a lot nicer when the deck is laid. A couple of taps of the hammer, force it home, and obviously the next one, same thing, glue in the hole, I've only had to do this 2,500 times. Right, so final plug about to go in. Better make sure we get the grain going the right way, otherwise my boss will be not very happy. All done. Okay, so deck's done, plugs are in. Next thing, you've got to take all the heads off the plugs. I'm going to sand the deck, clean the seams. Okay. So after we've done the deck, we've got our rub band going to go on here. Then the tow boards can go on, and then we can get the scaffolding down. Boats can be lifted, put back on the keel, then the engine can go in, and then we can get the rigging back on. Still quite a lot of varnishing to do, as you can see all around here, and our winch blocks back on, but at least we're moving forwards quite quickly, hopefully.
Well, here we are in October, and I've been away for 3-4 months now, and I just let them get on with it. And I've returned, and I'm pleasantly surprised that she's looking pretty good. They're just painting all the hole now and doing all the bright work. All the decks have been paved and all. The base for it has been fitted. The best work's been done downstairs. I think it would be fair to say that the best person to describe what's going on in my absence would be Rob, the boat builder, because there's far more going on than I even know about. When I left here, it was just the first layer of marine ply on the deck. And since then, they've put another layer on. Rotary deck on, and it's undergone many treatments to get it up to the level it is. We've got the tow rail, which has been made and put on, and now it's just in the final stages of having all the curling put on. And we've probably got about 8 coats now on this, so it should be very well protected. We'll have a look around the back of the boat, and we can show you the metalwork has been put around the windows, and it's comes together very, very well. I'll pass you to Rob.
Now the decks are all done, we've just got one more coat of oil to put on the decks. We've just made the tow boards and fitted all the stainless brackets to hold the tow boards so they're nice and solid. Now we're starting on all the deck fittings, working our way around the boat, putting all the cleats on, bowsprit, and working aft on the boat.
Go.
Right, as you remember, the windows have been changed from one to two windows. Which makes it a little bit more safe in the sea. So when the centrepiece was put in, we then made patterns up for the bronze outers. They were then sent off to the foundry, got made up and got polished by the polisher in Brixton. They've all been now fitted. We're just the final stage of doing it is just one coat of Carolan on the bronze to keep the colour in the bronze. Right, got new fuel tanks fitted. The old ones were leaking, and there was two tanks in there down and joined together, and they were leaking on the joint. So it was easy just to fit one, and we've reduced the amount of fuel as well, because you never use it. We've also changed the filler. Means instead of having a deck filler, we put a filler on the tank, which unscrews like that. And there's a inspection patch in the base of the floor, which you can put your hand through to fill the tank up. So it's completely sealed off from the boat, so you have no fuel leakage or anything like that. You've been busy?
Yeah.
Right, we've now finished the deck. All the fittings are going on as we speak now. So all really is left to do now is to fit the keel, which goes in under here. So tomorrow's job is to clean out all the keel bolt holes and clean out the holes in the keel. And hopefully it will fit. Right, these are the keel bolts. Silicon bronze, all brand new, newly machined. We've had washers made as well, and we've also had the nuts made, which are slightly different. They have a collar on them as well, because the standard nuts you normally get, they usually split across there after a couple of years. If they've got a collar on them as well, they can't split, so they'll go on. There's nut top and bottom, so the bolts will be pushed down through the hole. Let's get a clean one without the washers on. Then push down through the hole. You put the nut on the bottom, then you'll jack that up, and then you put the nut on the top and tighten the whole lot together. Right, on the hull, when you've got the keel bolts going through, they're bolted to the outside of the hull normally. And on this boat, you need to put a copper tingle on over the top. And it's basically, it's a secondary seal. So if the seal goes, or the cotton goes round the bolts and it will put in, once the tingles go down over the top, that's a secondary seal, so it will stop the engine bed bolts from leaking. Okay. Yeah, made out of copper. It can also be made out of lead as well. So lead doesn't corrode the same as copper. I'd prefer to use copper. They'll outlast the boat.
A very large one for the boat, it needs to be. It's set deep in the water. Again, it needs to be for keep steerage in heavy weather. This here is several timbers bolted together, and it's a very sturdy rudder.
So it's the 9th of October today. That's another milestone in the restoration of Windweaver.
She's going to get lifted back on her keel today, and then we can think about getting the engine and the mast back on. And then the launch date is the 26th of October, and this time we are going to keep it.
Exciting times today. Rob, the shipwright, has prepared the keel to be put back onto Windweaver. What's been done is we've put, Rob has put a layer of bitumen, a layer of felt, another layer of bitumen, another layer of felt, and some more bitumen. The bolts have all been put in situ, and they've all been sealed up as well. We've got two locator pins here to help locate the keel onto the boat. The boat will be lifted up and positioned over it. Hopefully it should all go smoothly. And then these will be knocked out and replaced with the proper bolts. The number 8 in all. All the bolts have been manufactured new, and hopefully they'll never come off again. Obviously, making sure the keel remains on the boat is very, very important, because without the keel on the boat, it's going to flip upside down. We're lucky with this type of boat because it's a long keel. The keel is built into the boat. On more of the modern fiberglass boats, the keel is a thin keel, and it's a very vulnerable part of the boat. And has happened many times in the past when we've bottomed the boat, it's leaking the structure, and the keels have fallen off in some cases with tragic consequences. This is never going to happen. So then, when the bolts are located up through the hole, we'll be putting a washer and this packing string around them before we put the nut on. The nut has been specially machined, got a collar on to give it the extra strength, so what we're going to do is it really, really tight. Where it feels and raking. The boat will sit on the keel for a day or two, and we'll come back and tighten them all up yet again. So we've got a very, very good seal against the boat.
see, we're now airborne. It's always a tricky point this, especially without the keel on her, because where they have to put the straps to lift, especially at the front of the bow, there's a good chance it could slip, so they tie the two slings together to hopefully stop that from happening.
Tense at the moment, we've got one chance to get this right. If one of those bolts locates in the wrong place, it's going to bend and we're going to have to start all over again. The rear bolt is located. Trying to locate the forward bolt at the moment. Improvised mallet. I think you're going to try and force this bolt up by lowering the boat. Lowering the boat onto the bolt. Just coming back a fraction. Not going up.
See, our first attempt of lining the keel up didn't go very well. Managed to get two bolts in out of eight, not very well. Realigning, hopefully go better this time.
after much manoeuvring, we have finally got the keel in situ. So the next part is to drive the bolts up. We're going to have to use a jack to jack those up through the holes and tighten them down.
Mammy told me,
away, haul away, we'll haul away, Joe.
That if I didn't kiss the girls, me lips would grow a moldy.
Away, haul away, we'll haul away, Joe.
Away,
ha! Haul away, we'll haul away together. Away, haul away, we'll haul away, Joe.
Away,
ha! Haul away, we'll haul for better weather. Away, haul away, we'll haul away, Joe.
King Louis was the King of France before the Revolution.
Away, haul away, we'll haul away, Joe.
But then he got his head cut off and he spoiled his constitution.
Away, haul away, we'll haul away, Joe.
Away,
haul away, we'll haul away together. Away, haul away, we'll haul away, Joe.
Away,
haul away, we'll haul for better weather. Away, haul away, we'll haul away, Joe.
The cook is in his galley, a making duffs a dandy.
Away, haul away, we'll haul away, Joe.
The captain's in his cabin, a drinking wine and brandy.
Away, haul away, we'll haul away, Joe.
Away,
haul away, we'll haul away together. Away, haul away, we'll haul away, Joe.
Away,
haul away, we'll haul for better weather. Away, haul away, we'll haul away, Joe.
Hey, can't you see the black cloud arising?
Away, haul away, we'll haul away, Joe.
Hey, can't you see the storm clouds are gathering?
Away, haul away, we'll haul away, Joe.
Away,
haul away, we'll haul away together. Away, haul away, we'll haul away, Joe.
Away,
haul away, we'll haul for better weather. Away, haul away, we'll haul away.
now, nearly 12 months to the day since you came out. It's taken much, much longer than we thought, obviously. We're very, very pleased now that we're nearing the end, both financially and the fact that we'll be able to sail her again soon. Yeah, so the engine has been completely overhauled, gearbox overhauled. It looks like a new engine. So that's all in place now. The launch is set for the 26th of October, so it's just over a week's time. And the boat will be taken around to Brixham, gently around to Brixham for a couple of weeks to be left in the water to soak up any water where she may need to. And then all the rigging then can be tightened down and tuned properly. I'm going to be disappearing for about a month, but when I get back, I'm rather hopeful we can go out on a couple of sea trials, as long as the weather is permitting. Maybe a little cross-channel trip. If it's not possible, we're going to leave it to the spring. Do some more cross-channels just to make sure everything's tuned up nicely. And then come June, we plan to do some long-distance sailing. We're going to take it down to the Azores, and we'll probably stop off at Spain and Portugal first, cross the Azores and back up again. And when we come back, we're hoping to enter the Plymouth to Brest rally, which is for all vintage vessels. And it's an annual event, and we're looking forward to perhaps competing seriously this year, since we'll have new sails and we'll the rest of it. And that's the first of many. We hope to do lots of classic boat rallies in the future.
Jeremiah Dixon, I am a Geordie boy. Glass of wine with you, sir, and the ladies I'm enjoy. Old Durham and Northumberland is measured up by my own hand. It was my fate from birth to make my mark upon the earth.
He calls me Charlie Mason, a stargazer am I. It seems that I was born to chart the evening sky. They'd cut me out for baking bread, but I had other dreams instead. This baker's boy from the West Country would join the Royal Society. We are sailing to Philadelphia, a world away from the coldy tide. Sailing to Philadelphia to draw the line, the Mason-Dixon line. Good surveyor Dixon, but I swear you'll make me mad. The West will kill us both, you gullible Geordie lad. You talk of liberty, how can America be free? A Geordie and a baker's boy in the forests of the Iroquois.
Now hold your head up, Mason, see America lies there. Morning tide has raised the capes of Delaware. Come up and feel the sun, a new morning has begun. Another day will make it clear why your star should guide us here. We are sailing to Philadelphia, Dixon line, the Basin line, Dixon line.
Thank you.